Mr. President, the renowned poet and author Maya Angelou wrote, and I quote, "History, with all its unending pain, cannot be outlived, but faced with courage, need not be lived again." I stand here today to once again lend my strong support, voted for, as the majority of our colleagues did, for the Violence Against Women Act. Nearly two decades ago, the Congress underwent an exhaustive investigation on the extent and severity of domestic violence and sexual assault toward women in this country. In hearing after hearing, senators heard from experts, including prosecutors, victim advocates, and physicians, and real-life stories of women that were the victims of these crimes. In response, Congress passed the Violence Against Women Act in 1994. This law quite literally changed the culture in our country. It changed how we view and address domestic violence and sexual assault. States across our country began to enact laws making stalking a crime and strengthened criminal rape statutes. Congress provided states with resources to train law enforcement and coordinate services related to domestic violence and sexual assault. But despite the progress we have made, our work is not done. One in every four women will experience domestic violence during her lifetime. In my home state of Montana, 98 people died from domestic violence between 2000 and 2010. These are not simply statistics. They are our mothers, our sisters, our daughters, our friends. They're people close to us. Since the passage of the Violence Against Women Act, women reporting domestic violence has increased by 51%, and the rate of non-fatal intimate partner violence against women has decreased by 53%. Congress renewed this critical legislation in the year 2000, again 2005. Both measures included improvements, and both those passed the Senate unanimously. We are here today to reiterate our commitment to addressing violence against women, including domestic abuse, sexual assault, dating violence, and stalking. I was struck recently by the story in the Billings Gazette, that's Billings, Montana, of Maria Martin. Maria was a victim of partner abuse. In the year 2005, the man she was dating went into a jealous rage. He held her hostage in her own home with a knife to her throat. He also threatened to kill her three daughters. Charges were filed. This man is now serving a 61-year prison term. Maria went on. She went on to earn her master's degree in rehabilitation and mental health counseling. She now helps others who find themselves in the situation she was in just a few short years ago. Maria told the reporter that programs created under the Violence Against Women Act provided her with the resources and support to overcome her situation. The act helped her find the courage she needed to see that this painful experience did not have to be lived again. It's counseling, a shelter for abused women, and law enforcement counseling, where law enforcement can be more sensitive to women who are victims of domestic violence. The bipartisan reauthorization renews grant programs critical to Montana, including those that support law enforcement, victim services, and prevention programs. And the bill consolidates 13 programs, many of which overlap, into four. This consolidation reduces administration costs, adds efficiency. Acknowledging the current fiscal realities, the bill therefore reduces authorization levels by 17% overall. It's more effective and it costs less. The bill also makes critical changes to address the pervasive domestic violence occurring in Indian country. Native Americans represent about 6% of Montana's population, about 6%. Yet Native women account for over 13% of victims reporting domestic violence in my state in the year 2008, about more than two times. According to the Department of Justice, Native women are 2.5 times more likely to be a victim of rape or sexual assault compared with non-Native women. However, it is the federal courts, not the tribal courts, which have jurisdiction over many of these crimes, including misdemeanor cases. With federal prosecutors stretched thin, especially large rural states like Montana, many cases go uninvestigated and criminals walk free to continue their violence with no repercussions. Chairman Leahy's bill carefully crafts a measure to extend concurrent criminal tribal jurisdiction to address the issue of domestic violence and partner abuse occurring in Indian country. These provisions will give tribal courts narrow jurisdiction to prosecute domestic violence or dating partner violence occurring on tribal land. The bill, however, safeguards those who might be defendants, provides safeguards to ensure that the defendant receives all rights guaranteed by the United States Constitution. This includes Fourth Amendment protections against search and seizure, Fifth Amendment privilege against self-incrimination, and Sixth Amendment right to effective assistance of counsel, all guaranteed in the statute. 50 law professors from across the country, including the University of Montana, wrote to Chairman Leahy in support of these provisions and Congress's constitutional authority to extend tribal jurisdiction. These provisions will begin to address the violence against Native women that has reached epidemic proportions. Maya Angelou is right that we cannot erase the past and what happened to Maria and others like her. But Maria's courage is proof that we can change these circumstances for others, to see that no one has to live through this experience. Maria said, and I'll quote her, "I'm alive today because I am a strong, intelligent woman. I need to stand up, step out, and be in front of this issue for others who can't or are not yet able to do it, at least not yet," end quote. So I urge my colleagues to support me in making sure that this act follows through in negotiations with the House and to get this reauthorization passed. It is so important to so many people in our country.